further maintenance obligations on the property, which I know you've had companies come out and bid on that, as well as other properties that you own. And it would also generate tax revenues for the township, which you haven't had in, since you've owned it, basically. So there are some other, there are additional benefits to this offer. If you choose to not accept the offer, which is within your purview to do, you should consider what that really means. And that is that you would have to put that on the open market to try and secure a buyer for it. I did talk to the local realtors in town today, and there's a 7 to 10% commission that the seller pays when they sell property. So that's going to come right off the top. So all of a sudden, your actual top dollar amount that you would sell that for is going to be reduced by 7 to 10%. In addition, during that time, whatever time it would take to sell the property, you are going to have the maintenance costs. You will not be collecting taxes. So the bottom line is you could actually get a higher offer later down the road that could actually net you less than what this offer is. Okay. I don't know about the demand for property such as this that's currently out there. I do know that Oscoda has taken a hit recently due to the contamination issues that we've been dealing with. Be they justified or not, it's still out there. And I have to wonder, would developers of any kind be interested in purchasing property that might have this type of contamination issues with it? We are prepared and ready to go forward with this offer. It would probably be in the range of, I'm guessing, 30 to 60 days that we would be able to close. There are some variables that are beyond our control, such as title work being secured. I don't know how long that would take. That's not up to us. Our loan officer that we've been dealing with has approved us for a $50,000 loan on this property. We are going to have some skin in the game on our own with this, because in addition to the purchase price of the property, we're going to have to cover the interest costs, we're going to have to cover our attorney's fees. So there's a number of other expenses that we've got in addition to that. But the bulk of the actual loan, we have a commitment letter from our bank, from First Federal, guaranteeing a $50,000 loan for the purchase of this property. Okay, so we are prepared to go forward with this. We feel it's a fair and reasonable offer. Yes, you can wait for the big bucks, but in the meantime, it does cost money to wait. So I just wanted to make the board aware of really all of the aspects of this offer. I know it's not what you wanted to get for the property on the offer, on the initial offer, but again, we feel it's a fair and reasonable offer. Our homeowners are comfortable with this. Our board of directors, which came tonight in support, they're comfortable with it. So we are prepared to go forward.
Okay.
Okay. Any questions?
Questions, anybody?
What's your intentions of doing with the piece of property?
Right now, nothing. Due to the contamination issues that may be present there, there have been some ideas floated that are basically low impact type of things. For instance, one thing that's been suggested is making a designated drone area. These drones that are so popular now, it'd be a perfect area for those. We'd have to check with the airport because there's a limitation on how close you can fly those things to active runways. Another suggestion was possibly to build a frisbee golf course there. Again, low impact, wouldn't cost much. And whatever we did with the property would not only be for the homeowners, this would be open to the public. We're not going to restrict or fence or do anything of the kind. This would just be basically a privately owned park is what it would be. So the public would have, if we did, for instance, put a frisbee golf course up there, If they wanted to start a league, for example, which in some areas it's a very popular thing, they'd be free to do that with no restrictions. We're not going to charge anybody for anything. It's just open to the public. And there may be other ideas that come to the surface later on that, you know, we haven't even heard from yet. But as far as developing or selling the property, that's not in our future. That's not something we are going to consider at all. Our biggest concern, I mentioned this before at one of the previous meetings, is the homeowners don't want a private developer to come in there and possibly put something in there that could be detrimental to the values, the existing values of the homes in the villages of Oscoda. We don't know what that could be. People's imaginations have been running wild with, what if they put this in there? What if they put a, you know, who knows what? And basically all of them would be detrimental, not positive for our property values. So rather than deal with any of that stuff, it was not our first choice to buy this. We really didn't initiate this at all. This was initiated by the township that kind of sprung it on us that they wanted to sell us, so we're just reacting to that. Okay. So.
Any other questions? All right, thank you.
Thank you.
We also have Rich Firebaugh, who would like to talk about the community center agreements that were extended to the Pickleball Association.
Good evening, and thank you for having me. I am Rich Firebaugh. By way of introduction, I'm an Oscoda kid. Raised in Oscoda, educated in Oscoda, left Oscoda to seek my fame and fortune. Found very little of each. back after retirement 5 years ago, and have loved almost every minute of it. Tonight I represent the Oscoda Area Pickleball and Recreation Association, and first of all, we saw some of you. We saw you at the tournament on Friday, and we appreciate those of you that were able to make it and that expressed interest in what we were doing out there. We had a fine tournament, 16 teams, a lot of great competition. Hopefully when you came out there, you saw that and enjoyed that. That tournament was won by an Oscoda team, okay? So we hold that for two more years. Shirts do say Oscoda Community Center on them. You'll note that, okay? Anyway, first of all, beyond that, we would like to tell you that on behalf of our membership, we received, of course, the Community Center Agreement for based upon our request for extended play, and after minimal discussion, from our membership, we have decided to respectfully decline to enter into that agreement with the township. There's a myriad of reasons, but primarily, you're essentially asking for an over $1,300 commitment from us, from a nonprofit group, which has about, as a treasurer, I'll tell you, has about $400 in the bank, before we'd even begin play, and frankly, we were somewhat offended by the rather boilerplate language, which included, and I understand that in some cases that agreement is perfect, you know, is perfectly acceptable and appropriate, but really, if we're going to go in and play in a gymnasium and hit a pickleball around, I don't think we should basically look at hanging items on walls, light fixtures, the cost of dumpsters, whether we're going to have liquor or not, cleaning hallways, janitorial services, cancellation scenarios associated to us bailing out on you. So with that said, we will obviously plan beginning on May and to play outside when we can, and if the weather is inclement, it's too risky to go out there and play out at the high school, then we will jump in cars and head to those good people down south at East Tawas to the community center where we'll play down there, and they'll heave a big sigh when about 10 or 15 of us show up, but we compete with them all the time, so they'll accept us. Remember though, and I found one thing from retirement back up here is that, you know what, people see travel as a form of recreation here, and they basically do a bunch of things on the way. When we go down there to East Tawas, guess what else is going to happen? We're going to eat in East Tawas, we're going to shop in East Tawas, we're going to do all those things that So we'll shop at Walmart instead of shopping at Family Fair. So just this little something to put away. Finally, no matter how you're inclined to view our response, let me leave you with this message from the Oscoda Area Pickleball and Recreation Association. We firmly believe, and not just the Pickleball Association, but lots of other people that use OCC. OCC is a jewel, an absolute jewel. And we believe that it needs to be open year-round. I didn't say full-time. I didn't say how many hours. Year-round. And we stand ready, despite this particular scenario, we stand ready to support endeavors to make that happen for the benefit of our community. We do believe that as we listened to you a couple of weeks ago, we know that some of you by history have some preconceived notions as to whether you believe that OCC would be successful being open year-round. I would ask you to basically, you know, Fritz Perls, if you know who Fritz Perls is, or even if you don't, look up Fritz Perls. Fritz Perls had something to say about the past, okay? I'll let you look it up because I don't want to get bleeped out here. But anyway, put the past away and rethink the process. And I heard the beep. Any questions?
You said 16 teams?
16 teams.
How many of those were from out of town, approximately?
It was primarily a split. There were eight Oscoda teams and eight East Tawas or surrounding area teams that were playing. That was five more than the first year. I truly anticipate, Jim, that we'll probably increase by another 50% next year. I'll bet you there are 24 teams playing out there next year, and we firmly believe at some point in the near future, we won't just be playing mixed doubles out there. We'll be looking at a two-day tournament out there. That's the way the sport's growing. But we're not just about pickleball either. I believe that OCC needs to be open year-round, not just for pickleball players. You know, the mean age, Bubba, here I go. The mean age in this county is almost 50. You realize that? Almost 50. The mean age in Michigan is 39. Look at where your constituents are. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Do we have any other cards?
We do not.
We do not. Okay. All right. The next item is consent agenda, approval of minutes. We have two sets of minutes, regular board meeting minutes from 2 weeks ago, and then we had a special board meeting on the 14th of April. Anybody see any problem with either set of minutes? Okay, second part of the consent agenda is financial report, payment of bills in the last 2 weeks, $137,826.65. About twice what it was last time. So any questions regarding any of the financial items? Hearing none. The final part of our consent agenda is the community center use agreements, Pickleball Association, which has been spoken to here recently, just now, and building and grounds maintenance employees transition to part-time, and the community development coordinator has some information about the new skate park trappings that were put in last week.
Yes.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Any comments from the board on any of that? Okay. The white fence around the splash park, did that come in this spring?
No, it was in way last summer.
At the end of?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Looks great, you know.
There's a couple more things that we're talking about, telling the board, or some of us were talking about.
Anyway, no, good job on getting that going. So. Mm-hmm. So if any of you haven't been down there recently, the skateboard park had kind of homemade ramps and so forth. And they're getting a little ripe. And So we kind of had to replace them by professionally done company that specializes in that.
Mm-hmm. American Ramp Company.
Yep. So. And again, the splash park, which is near the beach house shower building and stuff, is looking pretty good. So. Okay. All right. Okay. The consent agenda, I need a motion to accept it.
So moved.
Okay.
Support.
A move by Mr. Weed with support from Mr. Gajewski that we do accept the consent agenda as presented. Roll call.
Mr. Weed.
Yes.
Ms. Carrasco, yes. Mr. Cummings.
Yes.
Mr. Gajewski.
Yes.
Ms. McGuire.
Yes.
Mr. Byer.
Yes. Okay. Next, we go to the superintendent's report, and Bob has, beyond the informational items, he has about seven action items, and the first one is a executive secretary employment recommendation.
Yes, I had indicated when I distributed my report that a specific recommendation might be forthcoming before this evening. And that is in fact the case. On the board table and transmitted by email Friday is a recommendation that our utility billing clerk, Tammy Klein, be moved into the full-time executive secretary position. Tammy has been with the township for about a year and a half in the utility billing position, has demonstrated proficiency in performing those duties, and also when serving as an occasional backup for our current executive secretary. If the board were inclined to proceed with the recommendation, I would suggest starting pay of $12.99, which is exactly one penny more than she's making now. And that would be for the first 6 months, contingent upon satisfactory performance. I would suggest moving her to year one pay grade for the executive secretary, which is $13.39 per hour. And in conclusion, if we move forward with this, I would suggest the effective date of the promotion, if you will, would be April 26, which is tomorrow, which would give her more time and full-time capacity to benefit from the presence of our existing executive secretary until she leaves the township's employment next week.
Questions? All right.
I do have one. How many other candidates were there, or were there any?
There were. There were probably 10. We interviewed four.
Okay. And is this candidate the best of the, I presume, four?
Frankly, with these types of situations, that is a value judgment. I believe so, but okay. But there were other folks in contention for the position, to be candid.
I got it.
What are you going to do for a building square count?
Advertise immediately.
I'll make a motion to hire Tammy Klein as the executive secretary at a starting pay of $12.99 after a 6 month probation period, increased pay to $13.39 per hour.
Support.
Okay. Any further discussion? All right, roll call.
Mr. Gajewski?
No.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Mr. Weed?
Yes.
Ms. Carrasco, yes. Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Mr. Byer?
Yes. Motion is carried. Okay, next item, number two, operation and maintenance agreement with Fleece and Vandenbrink.
Yes. There have been several discussions recently with F&V regarding the contract renewal process. Those discussions have resulted in the contract document that was included in the board packet, which is presumably nearing final form. There is additional discussion that's going to be needed to refine and finalize the document. I note, because it's been a topic of consideration in the not too recent past, that the indemnification provision is one of the topics under discussion. I've also provided a copy of the current contract document for purposes of comparison and information. Based upon the discussion when we went into the renewal process for this agreement, I bring your attention to and focus to paragraphs starting with 1.08 that deal with non-routine services. There has been a fair amount of discussion about that. Basically, non-routine services would require pre-approval except under emergency circumstances. The basic definition that we are attempting to put in place in defining routine versus non-routine services is, in addition to the language that's there, the normal workday would be considered routine, basically for certain things that occur after hours that fall into the potential non-routine category would require pre-approval, again, unless there's an emergency situation, and the process is spelled out there as to what would happen. Also, in terms of non-routine services and that process, I bring your attention to paragraph 3.05 that deals with new water and sewer services and fine frozen water services, which based on the past several years, we know can be a difficult issue. Again, we're looking at the distinction there between work accomplished during the normal day and work accomplished after hours. There is also, in keeping with the board's direction, a provision that provides a guarantee, if you will, that at least we will engage in good faith negotiation if we go to an automated meter reading process. We talked about establishing the $50,000 cost reduction if we went to quarterly meter readings as a floor. As you might imagine, from the company's standpoint, there's some question there depending on how much of the system is converted, when it's converted in the contract, all those kinds of things. But I guess the bottom line is there's a willingness to engage in those discussions. Again, using that $50,000 is sort of a floor for the savings. In the final analysis with the routine versus non-routine issue, there are still some differences of perspective, despite the fairly lengthy discussions, not only recently, but over the course of the previous contract. And the acknowledgement in the contract that some services can be non-routine does create a liability and the potential for additional cost for the township. Again, subject to those conditions that I'm mentioning, but I think everybody should be aware that that potential is still there. If more recent experience is indicative of what we can expect moving forward, that should be limited. That situation seems to have become mitigated quite a bit. But again, there is the potential for a claim, and we may be confronted with some of those requests for additional fees. We're fast approaching the termination date for the existing agreement, and we need to move towards getting a new agreement in place prior to that. So at this point, given where we are with the contract, some discretion will be necessary in terms of allowing the supervisor and clerk to sign the document. The alternative would be a special meeting. My suggestion is the board consider authorizing execution of a final document, which is substantially similar to the one we're looking at this evening, assuming that is acceptable. If it's not, that's a different matter, frankly. With the understanding then that if there were any substantive changes, we would move towards a special meeting. And obviously, if anybody has any specific comment on the content of the document, we can take that up with our service provider in trying to finalize it. I did receive one comment in response to my report, which we'll be talking to F&V about. And that involves the indemnification provision and the commitment on behalf of the township being limited to as allowed by Michigan law.
All right. And I think the board should consider here that, you know, with the water issue that we have out in the base, that could potentially mean some beyond service activity by F&V also, like the frozen water lines that we had before. So, you know, you don't know at this stage what it's going to involve, but it surely could. And am I right that the contract with F&amp;V is a 5-year contract, the one that we are in now?
The 3-year.
3, and it ends in 7 days or 6? So, okay. May 2, to be exact. Yeah, so. Okay. Any other further comments?
On this quarterly billing, is that going to be for residential only, or is it going to be for commercial and residential?
Well, that was a proposal that they had made in the response to the RFP. So we are simply using that as sort of a baseline savings amount, a mechanism to enter into discussions if we go to automated reading. We had sent them, I think, the message at that point in time that we didn't believe quarterly meter reading would be appropriate in the event that there were leaks or that type of thing that could go on for a very long time. So we're not contemplating doing that now, but the savings that they said would generate from it would seem to be, at a minimum, a good point to talk about in terms of $50,000 plus coming off the contract.
Could be less, more than that, too.
It could.
I'd prefer to not be on quarterly reading.
Me too.
I prefer that just for the residents alone.
About
they have a hard time paying it monthly.
Yeah, quarterly would be disastrous.
Yeah.
Agreed.
Okay. Well,
I'll make a motion that the supervisor and clerk execute the agreement based on the above parameters and the attached draft, unless there's something earth-shaking that they need to have a special meeting or bring it back to the board.
Support. Okay. Moved by Ms. McGuire and with support from Mr. Weed that we do go ahead with the F&amp;V Operations Resource Management Agreement. Roll call, please.
Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Mr. Weed?
Yes.
Ms. Carrasco? Yes. Mr. Beyer?
Yes. Okay, moving to item 3 of 7, Land Use and Recreation Master Plan Survey.
During our recent work session and special meeting kind of combined discussion, the topic of the survey that was going to be prepared, which is under review by the Planning Commission, was broached in terms of that document containing some content relating to the Recreation Master Plan. And at that point, the board had expressed some interest in looking at the draft survey. So that is in what I have attached to my report. And I am seeking input from the board as to modification of the survey. My suggestion is if the survey is considered to be in need of significant review and input, that consideration might be given to creating an advisory committee to do that review. But that's a value judgment based on how close to acceptable you think the document is.
Okay. Discussion on this point.
How are these going to be distributed and made people aware that they're available?
We will put them on the website. They will advertise that it is available on the survey instrument and try and encourage people to access that instrument and complete the survey. So I would say newspaper, our message sign, website, etc. Try to kind of cast a broad net.
Our website is an option for people to fill in for being on a mailing list. How many people are on that list?
Don't know offhand.
I've got a few things that I'd like to see adjusted on the survey. Let me know what you guys think of these. In question number 9, well, first of all, let me premise this, that I feel this survey was very focused on only this 15% of the eastern side of the township. We have that whole other side, and knowing what goes on the whole other side does have an impact on what happens on this side. So on question number 9, I would like to add another line item in there for recreational opportunities.
This is on page 3, right?
Page three, correct.
Okay, any objection or? Sounds okay.
Number 18. Which of the Oscoda Township parks have you visited recently? Many people who live here are not aware of the names of several of our parks, so I think it should have included with it the location of the park, so we know where we're talking about.
Where's Fireman Park? I never, what is that?
Yeah. To the point.
Exactly.
Bob?
The Fireman Park.
I think that's Footsite.
Right. Yeah, they actually have it listed twice, and I think Fireman Park was more at the fire hall. So technically it's not there anymore. So that needs to be, I have that highlighted down.
There was a swing set there. Precinct two, the old precinct two where the swings were.
Point, yes.
Okay.
Yep, so I have that highlighted.
I had no idea what that was.
It lists the community meeting room as a park.
Yeah, I put that as not a park as well.
And it would be nice to see all the other state and federal parks that we have in our township listed on here. Again, so that we can understand the use of those areas. Because I know some people say one lake is a jewel in the township over another one. Never know what the response is, we could find out differently.
So you would like to see, for instance, the monument in Huron?
Lumberman's Monument. Foot Pond, Loud Pond, Five Channels, Cook Pond, the Corsair Trails, Whirlpool.
That's Corsair's, not Oscoda Township.
What would you think if we made that a separate category?
What is Eagle Run? I'm sorry.
Eagle Run.
That's fine, separate category, as long as we've included all those options.
Non-township parks, okay. Because I think that would dilute our ability to get a clear idea of which of our parks is the most popular or the least, you know. So maybe a separate, you know, separate category of non-township parks and recreational facilities. But that flies in the face of a comment that I had. This is a 9-page long survey. Do you think people are gonna, is that gonna dissuade people from jumping in, or is it too long?
Well, we're only talking 2 or 3 questions per page.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, as long as we remember your survey's only as good as the people taking it, if you only have 50 people out of 7,000 taking a survey.
To that point, can we market it? Could it be something we could put on the electronic sign out in front, or in other ways that we could, you know, encourage people to participate?
Paper copies of it available at the clerk's office or something?
We can put it on our calendar too. Yeah. Right. When Asable Township just went through the same process, actually it was put in the e-blast by the chamber. And there was a direct link. So you went on, it said take the survey, you click it, and it goes right to the survey online.
Oh, that's excellent.
I'm sure we could utilize that as well.
I have a question, Jim, from the man who wrote part of that survey.
I can answer some of your questions.
Go ahead, right there.
Okay. They have a website at www.oscodasurvey.com that will be introduced. There'll be a direct link to it. There will be copies at the Township Hall, at the library, and they are going to put an ad through social media sites that will reach over 7,000 people in the area. That's
perfect.
The plan right now.
Okay. Excellent.
All right.
Thanks, Bob. On question 20, I think paved multi-use paths needs to be better defined, because that could be just about anything. And also to include ATV, UTV, off-road motorcycle, snowmobiling, snowshoeing, and off-roading.
I don't think you guys have the updated survey.
Really? This don't look like
we talked about these things, and we talked about Cross-country skiing, we talked about snowmobiling, we talked about, I don't see any of that information in here.
No.
Cross-country skiing on there.
Cross-country's on there.
I don't see a date about it.
I don't see snowmobiling though.
Did you have two versions, one initially and then it was?
We brought one for review.
Yeah.
We critiqued it, brought up some of the same questions.
Okay.
And.
Did you say winter sports?
That was at our last meeting.
Okay, which was about a week ago.
It was the first of the month, first Monday of the month.
Do you want to, board members, do you want to?
I'd like to see the.
See the latest copy plus the adjustments that we've talked about tonight?
Yeah.
And then look at it again?
For question 15, did you add M65?
I talked about that.
Okay. Fantastic.
I was outvoted on it, by the way.
I think we need M65 on there.
On what one, 15?
Question 15, asking where future development should be located. We may receive a very low response rate on it, but again, who knows what we get?
Right.
That's right.
True. Okay, we'll look at this again.
I am presuming this is, I'll check with the zoning administrator, but assuming that this is the current version, would you still like to have it come back for another review?
Well, apparently it isn't because Bob is very much involved in it and he's saying that a lot of stuff is missing.
Well, we can double check that.
Okay.
Okay.
We didn't get our final draft to review either. You're supposed to show us also, we haven't.
Okay.
Seen it.
Okay.
All right. Do you think you can find some time to talk to Mr. Stalker about some of these issues? Good. All right.
Anything else, Eric?
That's it. Thank you.
Okay, so that would take care of the action that you're asking for here.
It would.
Yes.
Yes.
All right, next item, item four, scheduling of strategic planning work session.
We, at our last strategic planning work session, spent a significant amount of time talking about specific topics and didn't get through the goal and objective statement. That would lead towards the conclusion potentially that we should consider scheduling another work session where we could focus on that goal statement and presumably get through the document. I had in my report suggested the dates of May 4 or May 5. It's appearing as though May 4 may not be a good date and the morning of May 5th may be problematic. So given those dates, it's looking tentatively like the afternoon of the 5th would be most appropriate.
Does that sound like something? The afternoon of, that's Thursday, right?
Right.
What time in the afternoon? Early afternoon or?
Certainly at the board's discretion.
I'm not available on the 5th.
How about Friday the 6th in the morning?
No, not from the 5th and a week and a half after that, I'm not available.
Jeez, oh Pete.
Well.
But that's fine.
I've told the board before that I have real problems with getting there Thursday morning. So I did make an effort last time for part of the meeting, but I'd rather not have to do that again.
Bob, can we do Tuesday the 3rd? In the morning or afternoon? Afternoon, probably.
But I have to check my calendar now to see if those days are available because people schedule the room for different things. So we can tentatively do it until I double check everything.
You have an appointment in the morning, right, Mr. Byer?
You have Tuesday morning?
Tuesday morning and Thursday morning, yeah.
We could establish a tentative time and then call back and confirm and then post accordingly.
The 3rd okay with everybody else?
In the afternoon?
Afternoon.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what, Tuesday, May 3rd?
Yep.
Okay. Make it work.
What time?
3 o'clock?
Fine with me.
I'll make a motion.
All right.
Okay. Support.
Motion by Ms. McGuire with support from Mr. Weed that we do go Tuesday the 3rd and at 3 o'clock. Roll call, please.
Mr. Weed?
Yes.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Ms. Carrasco, yes. Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Mr. Byer?
Yes. Okay, item five, dust control. Getting to be that time of the year?
Yes, it is. Keeping with our normal practice, we have solicited bids, and I've attached the request for proposals that we utilized in a bid tabulation sheet. The low bid for 26% mineral brine, which is the product we've used in recent years, is provided by Liquid Calcium Chloride Sales of Cock Holland at a price of 2.05 cents per gallon. And I'm seeking the board's consideration in accepting the proposal from Liquid Calcium Chloride to do our program this year.
And everything was satisfactory with this company in previous years?
We've had a good experience. I can't say, there have been instances where they've had to come back and so forth.
But they're willing to do that?
Yeah, they've been good to work with, yes.
I make a motion to go forward with Liquid Calcium Chloride Sales.
Support.
For mineral brine application.
Support. Got that?
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Before we vote on that, Jim, Bob, that isn't that 20 and a half cents the way it's written on the...
Mm-hmm.
And you said 2.5 cents a gallon?
Two point oh five cents.
Okay, it's not 20 and a half like it's written there.
No.
Oh, okay.
No.
It's 2 cents per gallon?
Yeah.
Too much. Too much.
Yeah, the decimals get to be a little much.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions?
No.
Thank you, Martin. Roll call, please.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Mr. Weed?
Yes.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Ms. Carrasco, yes. Mr. Byer?
Yes. Okay, item six, State Street Square, which is this building, appraisal.
Yes. We had engaged the services of a private appraising firm to establish an independent value for this building. I've attached a summary of that appraisal, the findings, which was received recently. And you might recall that the purpose of the appraisal was to garner information that might be utilized in establishing a minimum bid amount if we were going to seek competitive proposals for selling the building. I've also provided a copy of the value established by the Township Assessor's Office, which appears to be consistent with the appraisal amount. So the basic questions then this evening are, first, reaffirming that we would in fact consider selling the building. If so, what would the process be? If it's going to be a competitive bid solicitation process, then hopefully this appraisal will give us some guidance in establishing a minimum bid amount, assuming that's the route that we would like to go. And again, that's what we had talked about before.
And the appraisal amount is?
Is
$282,500.
Okay. And that includes, of course, it sounds silly, but it includes this room because we have another assessment that is for the three-quarters of the building without this room. Is that correct?
Yeah, I think the potential confusion there, as I understand it, is the full text of this appraisal includes reference to a figure that is substantially less from the assessor's office, but that does not incorporate this space because it's not income producing. The actual number from the assessor's office is, I believe, about $250,000.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm confused. In the request to have this building assessed, didn't you just say we want to know what the building is worth, not pick apart rooms or...
how come we can't have a simple deal where the assessment for this building, regardless what the build, the rooms are used for, income producing or government activities? Tell me again in baby steps, what is the assessment for this building from?
The appraiser's value, again, for the building and the property is $282,500.
And our assessment across the street, our assessor, Nancy, her figure is?
Approximately 250, I believe.
Yep, 249,947.
Including?
Including the entirety of this space, yes.
Okay.
Where the confusion comes in again is there was mention made of a lower figure out of the assessor's office in this appraisal, but that figure did not include non-income producing space.
So bottom line, 280 roughly, and 250 roughly?
Yeah, ballpark, yes.
Okay. Well, does the board want to deal with this tonight, or do you want to consider how you want to handle it, and in 2 weeks come back? I mean, there's many options. Do you want to average this in? Do you want the prospective buyers to come up with their own assessment and somehow work that in? What? What would be a good way to go?
I imagine a buyer would assess it themselves. I mean, they would get their own appraisal if they really were interested. I mean, they wouldn't necessarily just take ours.
Right. So we should give them a chance to do that.
Sure. But it's the initial
at their expense.
Of course, yes. And the initial question was whether we were interested in selling the building.
Yes.
So maybe that's just that's the good starter question. I'm in favor.
Maybe that's good for the work session.
Possibly. Why were we considering a competitive bid? You know, it's not like we've had 10 people knocking the door down to buy the place.
Because that's one method of ensuring you're getting the best price for the building.
Sure.
And it hasn't been advertised in the past on the open market, like, say, buildings on Wordsmith that have been, a value's been established and they've been marketed, and then a single buyer comes along, but other folks had a chance at it, kind of thing.
There was a front page story in the newspaper, but dealing with the possible sale of this building, but not everybody reads the newspaper, you know, so. So we can touch on it at the work session, and just kind of kick it around and come up with something more precise in 2 weeks. Is that the will of the board? I'm not
That's fine.
Trying to be a dictator here
not
at all.
At all. So. No, I'm in favor of that.
Okay. What's stopping you? Is that what you said? I heard you say that.
I didn't say that.
Okay. All right, well, let's handle it that way, yes.
No, he was not.
No, he was making fun of Jim.
Thought you had a question, JD.
No.
Was that a Nazi salute that y'all came? All right, item seven then. Wastewater improvements, progress payment number six.
Yes, in keeping with our ongoing improvement project, we have progress payment number six, which would be made to RCL Construction. In this case, the amount being approved potentially would be $40,332.60. That's the amount the engineer has certified. However, they are suggesting, and I would concur, that the payment be reduced to compensate for an overpayment relating to a change order. So with that understanding, I am suggesting that progress payment number six be approved as recommended by our engineer.
Okay, any discussion?
Where are we with that, Bob? How soon are they gonna be completed?
The deadline for it to be complete per the DEQ permit is mid-September. Hopefully we will be a month or two ahead, but that's uncertain. It's partly dependent on when they get the septage out of the lagoon facility. That's when really they'll be able to
But right now, we're basically staying on schedule, so to speak?
My understanding is that we are, although some concerns have been raised recently about the volume of sewage in the lagoons, so we may need to talk about that moving forward.
Okay, and your last sentence, I note that the actual payment to be made will be reduced to compensate for an overpayment relating to a change order, so the payment will actually be $29,000-something.
Correct, $29,063.60.
Instead of $40,332.
Right.
Yeah, because the clerk overpaid the last time.
I'll make a motion that we approve progress payment number six in the amount of $40,332, with the understanding it's going to be reduced to compensate for the overpayment.
Support.
Okay, roll call, please.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Ms. Carrasco, yes. Mr. Weed?
Yes.
Mr. Byer?
Yes. Okay, now before we leave Mr. Stalker's report, because this was part of it, just a comment about one of his earlier items, and Mr. Firebaugh's comments and stuff like that. I've already brought this up twice a week or two ago, and I'm not trying to renew the battle. I'm just making an observation. And maybe I'm wrong someplace, but when we talked about this before, 2 weeks ago, and then at the work session, the board was concerned about the pickleball people, that they didn't have any insurance and they should have, and these legal statements, what's the term I'm looking for, that they each would sign, hold
harmless.
Yeah, what was not enough. And then there was also a concern about we're going against policy by having an activity after the facility was closed at the end of this month, in a few days to be exact.
I don't mean to interrupt you, but yeah. Should this be safe to board comments also because it doesn't follow the agenda?
I just as soon get it. Like I said, I mentioned it because it's part of Bob's deal, and before we leave that. And we have some people here that are interested in this and may not stay till the end. So there was also concern about keys and that they would have access to the building. And then there was also the money, and we talked to this before. It was $1,680. I think you mentioned $1,300. Where'd you get that number?
Well, there's a $500 damage deposit.
Oh, yeah.
So if we were to play in one gym, that would have been $35 an hour.
Okay.
$105.
Gotcha. Okay. But anyway, I guess my only comment is that the first three of those things seem to have gone away in this offer, and the article doesn't seem to be too concerned about insurance. I guess you don't need it now. Activities after April 30th closing, that's not a concern anymore. The keys thing is not addressed, but the money is $1,680. I just suggest it makes us look like bean counters here. The other stuff that we thought was really important 2 weeks ago has vanished, but the price is still there. And I don't know. It just, what happened to these other things that were equally important? Well, that's the end of my comment. So, all right, let's go on to the community development coordinator. Ann Richards.
Hey. Great. So,
I've got to say what you're
doing. Oh, okay. I thought I would jump in and say what.
Jump all over me.
All right.
Okay. action item, work session follow-up and direction confirmation.
Okay. Thank you. As a result of our most recent work session on Thursday, April 14th, there is one follow-up action necessary in regard to the township-owned property at 6121 Perimeter Road. This building is currently being leased by Seisen Schmidt, and based on their notice to not renew their lease, which is expiring in March 2017, not March 2016, actually, that I indicated in my report, but is being marketed for lease. As explained at the work session, I have been approached by an entity inquiring as to whether the township board would consider selling the property. Based on discussion at the work session, I'm seeking confirmation that the board would like to market the property for sale in addition to the current option to lease. If the board is inclined to move forward with a sale option, I'm seeking direction in regard to the method the board would like to use to set the fair market price. Specifically, should an appraisal be sought as it appeared, which is what appeared to be the preference based on the work session discussion, or in an alternate, staff could seek a recommendation from the township assessor in order to establish a fair market price or a combination of the two. Obviously, we just recently been discussing that with this building, so. So looking for direction.
Are they either now in or are they still in?
No, that was a mistype on my part. Their lease is good until March 2017, I don't think they'll be there until that time. We've been preliminarily told end of June, but now it might be a little bit later than that. So we have showed the building to a few different people. So if they vacate and there's a new tenant that we haven't agreed upon lease, you know, I mean, the township could consider releasing them from the rest of their lease, but that will cross that bridge when it comes. But they are liable for their lease until March of 2017.
Well, what's the will of the board here?
I say we market it to sell and get an appraisal just like we did.
I agree.
Okay. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Support.
Okay. Ms. McGuire with support from Mr. Weed. That we go ahead and investigate, pursue the possible sale of that building, but first an assessment. Okay. All right, roll call.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Ms. Krasko, yes. Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Mr. Weed?
Yes.
Mr. Byer?
Yes. For the information of the audience, the Seitz & Schmidt Corporation, a German company that's been around for about 150 years, was purchased by a Canadian company. Lindemark or something like that?
Lindemar, I believe.
Lindemar?
Mm-hmm.
And they have made the choice, since Seitz & Schmidt is now just a branch of Lindemar. They already have facilities that do similar work in North Carolina, and so the Canadian company, not the Germans, has decided that they should leave and go to North Carolina. Right now, there are about two or three general workers out there and one administrator, and they're going to be there for another month or two, my information, so. Okay. VA expansion project.
Okay. On the agenda this evening is invoice number 10, dated April 21st from J.E. Johnson, in the amount of $107,864 for work completed and stored to date on the VA project. Also on the invoice from J.E. Johnson, they pointed out the fact that the Midmark purchase was made direct instead of running through J.E. Johnson. That was done, Midmark is the manufacturer of the casework, countertops, sinks, all like the exam room fixtures. We were given a letter from the VA allowing us to purchase that under GSA pricing, government pricing. We started the process with an original, with one sales rep, and he had said that that was fine to run it through J.E. Johnson, that it didn't have to go technically direct between either the township or the VA as a government agency. Halfway through the process, that sales rep left the company, and when it came time to actually ordering it, the in-house people would not allow us to run it through J.E. Johnson without charging taxes. So to avoid the tax amount, we purchase it direct so that we could get GSA pricing without having to pay the taxes. So otherwise it would have been about almost 4,500 that wouldn't have been part of the tenant improvement cost that we would have been reimbursed by the VA. So anyways, I just wanted to point that out. That's why it was purchased direct. Okay. But it all is part of the tenant improvement that we'll be reimbursed for.
Okay.
Okay, so just wanted, I don't know when the last time anybody has been in there, but it's really taken some drastic changes lately. All the floor coverings are pretty much done. They're laying tile right now in most of the bathrooms. The main area of the entrance does not have the carpet yet. They'll be doing that last so that, because, you know, of traffic flow from the outside, and the vestibule itself has to be weather tight before they put that carpet in. The casework has all been installed. Exterior site work to the parking lot's in full swing. They pretty much have all the curb set and ready for the asphalt plants open on May 1st, which is Sunday. So they'll start asphalt work next week to the parking lots. And then we also have window and door installation that's currently in process in the vestibule entrance, as well as the, you know, we've combined this project with the dental clinic entrance as well. So we have some work going on there.
Okay. So you're not looking for any vote or action here? Because
we have to approve the payment. Approve the payment. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Do we have a motion to approve the payment?
So moved.
Okay. Move by Mr. Cummings with support from Mr. Gaskin. And that payment is $107,864. Anything else on that? If not, roll call.
Mr. Weed?
Yes.
Mr. Krasko, yes. Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Mr. Gaskin?
Yes.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Mr. Byer?
Yes. All right. Next is the Michigan Natural Resources Trust Fund, DNR, Natural Resources Trust Fund, acquisition grant item.
Correct. A while back, we shared with the board that we were given a preliminary award notice that we did receive our grant funding, and it was all based on the governor allocating that money. We actually have received notice that the funds have been approved and allocated by the governor for the recommended 2015 round of Michigan Natural Resources Trust Fund projects. Attached to my report was a copy of the project agreement that is necessary for the grantee, the township, to sign and return to the department within the time frame of June 5th with all the attachments. There are several requirements that are outlined in the project agreement that need to be submitted with the completed agreement. One of those requirements is to provide a resolution confirming the township's commitment of the local share for the acquisition of the property. According to the grant agreement, that amount is $146,300. The sum represents 26% of the total eligible costs of the acquisition, including incidental costs. That resolution is on the agenda later on. It's resolution 2016-09. And then also this evening, I'm seeking authorization to execute the project agreement as presented.
Okay, and the grant was, refresh us, how much are we getting?
416,000.
465.
Don't wait a minute, don't quote me on that. I might be confusing that with the, here for some reason. 416 sticks in my head. Yeah, 416. Oh, look at that, I was right. $416,000 is the grant amount.
Okay.
416.2, sorry.
All right. In this Natural Resources Trust Fund, I've explained this before when we've talked, a lot of our money to build the pier came from this same fund. So we're getting a little less than $500,000. And it comes from like royalties that come from companies that access minerals in Michigan, whether it be oil, natural gas, copper, iron, whatever. They have to put some money in this pot. And the DNR oversees this and deals it out like cards to people that have recreation projects. This will be the second time we've got $400,000+ from this grant, so kind of a good deal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, third time.
Third?
Because we are getting money for the bike path also.
Oh, okay, that's right. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Okay, bike path also. Okay. And I think the county requested, the county has a a park idea. It would be the first county park, and it happens to be in Oscoda Township of the 11 townships. And if it goes through, I think they are applying, and maybe they've already received a positive response. I'm not sure.
The bike, just to clarify, the bike path one was presented by the county, but it is money coming into Osceola and Oscoda Township.
Okay, mm-hmm. All right. Okay, but that's what the Michigan Natural Resources, just the name Natural Resources Trust Fund is all about. So, okay, informational item, lawn maintenance.
Don't you need authorization?
Authorization to execute the project agreement.
I make a motion.
I'm so excited about it.
I make a motion to authorize for execution of the project agreement as required by the grant.
Support.
Okay. Motion by Mr. Weed and support from Mr. Gajewski. Okay. Roll call, please.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Mr. Weed?
Yes.
Ms. Crespo, yes. Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Ms. Byer?
Yes. Okay, now, lawn maintenance issue.
Correct. Based on direction from the board at the April 14th special meeting, I've requested the township attorney to prepare a contract with North Coast Landscaping in the amount of $54,400 to contract the lawn care maintenance services for the Worsmith District and Footsite Park and Boat Launch area. A copy of that contract was attached to my report for your information and review. This evening I distributed an updated agreement sheet. There was two changes that were made, one underneath consideration, indicating the time period of the project, which was 7.5 months or 30 weeks, and then that payment was going to be made twice a month. And then we also added a under the term of agreement the option to make modifications to the contract. So, because as you might recall, it was a 3-year contract. Pricing was 1 year. And so that if for some reason, we're not happy with service or so, something like that, we could terminate the contract. It wouldn't be set for 3 years. And also the option of removing property as we sell. So.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Ann.
Mm-hmm.
We move on to ordinances and resolutions, and tonight we have two resolutions. The first is resolution number 2016-10.
This resolution addresses a subject that Ann just talked to you about, and that is the acquisition grant. It reaffirms our acceptance of the grant agreement, but also stipulates several other conditions. It's based on the standard form that we get from the state of Michigan. We're committing the local match of $146,300, which will vary based on the approved appraisal amount, maintaining financial records, reserving the property for use of the public on equal and reasonable terms, and to comply with the agreement terms that aren't specifically set forth. So consistent, I believe, with the form of the trust fund resolution for several years now.
Okay, and I my mistake was to call it 2016-10 because that's the way I have it in my booklet, but it is not 2016-09. So any questions on this?
I make a motion to go forward with resolution 2016-09.
Okay.
Support.
All right. Motion by Mr. Weed with support from Mr. Gajewski. Okay. All right. You guys sound alike to me. But all right. Roll call, please.
Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Mr. Weed?
Yes.
Ms. Crespo? Yes. Mr. Byer?
Yes. Okay. Now, 2016-10.
This resolution is follow-up to discussion we had previously relative to billing in hundreds of gallons versus thousands for water and sewer services as a means to improve on our water system accountability. Effective on today's date, if the resolution is adopted, we would change the methodology. I have confirmed that our billing software will in fact support the change. There's a provision in here that says if it will not support billing in increments of 0.1 cent, we would round up. I am advised that it will in fact do that, but that will not show up on the customer's bills. So just for purposes of information, it's probably important everybody know that.
So for May's bill, this will take place?
Actually, it'll be June because we're just beginning the cycle.
Okay.
Okay.
It's gonna be the bill in May, but the one that's due in June.
Due in June.
Right, right, correct. That's when the billing would be.
Yeah, so that's an answer, I guess, to both questions there.
Are we gonna, is Tammy gonna type a little something up or put anything on? I know she has some email addresses or there's a spot on the billing. Maybe she could put a message on there or something, letting people know that it's going to be taking place, because not everybody comes to the meeting, reads the newspaper, or watches the show, so.
We can do that.
Might be a little bit. And maybe a little type something up and I can put it on our counter where we take the water payments. Might help them explain a little bit what's gonna be happening.
Certainly.
Thank you.
Okay. All right, we're moving to other.
Nope, we need a.
Oh, we need a motion on this water sewer rate.
I'll make a motion that we approve resolution number 2016-10.
Support.
Beat you. Meyer, Meyer. All right. Roll call, please.
Ms. Brasco, yes. Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Mr. Weed?
Yes.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Mr. Fire?
Yes. Okay, now under other, which we just kind of created, is if you have a copy of the agenda, it's not there, but we added a couple items at the beginning of the meeting, and the first one is employee transfer.
Yes, and the reason this has been delayed is there was some due diligence that had to be completed, otherwise it would have been in the packet. But in any event, the board has recently approved the administrative consolidation plan, and the administrative secretarial position in the community development office will be eliminated. We have a vacant clerical assistant position in the police department, and the idea here is that the current employee could move into that clerical assistant position. In the case of the administrative secretary, we're talking a 20-hour per week part-time position. Clerical assistant is normally 24 hours. Pay rate for the employee in question is currently $14.88. That is the maximum for the clerical assistant position, the very top end of that scale. If the board were to approve the transfer, my suggestion is that it be done May 9th, which would allow Mary to spend some time helping with the administrative transition and also to begin training in the clerical assistant function as time allows. The suggestion is that the transfer of Mary Morawa into the vacant part-time clerical assistance position be approved at her current pay rate to be effective May 9th.
Okay. Do we have any questions regarding this transfer? Anybody? A motion to go ahead with that.
Someone.
Motion is by Mr. Cummings and support from Ms. Carrasco. How about that? Consolation.
For variety.
Okay. Any further comment or questions regarding this transfer? If not, roll call, please.
Mr. Weed?
Yes.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Ms. Carrasco, yes. Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Mr. Byer?
Yes. Okay, second added item under other is what we heard of earlier in the first public comment, the offer from the villages of Oscoda for purchase of the 5,000 area, and again,
8,000,
yeah, all right. The area, even though I can't handle the number, is that when you drive in what used to be called the back gate of the, you know, and And I believe it is Bissonnet is the road, and as you drive in, after you get in a couple blocks on your right, there is this vast open area where some pretty rundown housing was there and was demolished with funds that came from Senator Levin, I believe, you know, some time ago. But that is the so-called 8,000 area. So, and, what is the board's wishes regarding the 50,000? Do you want to accept that? Do you want to turn it down? Do you want a counteroffer? There's all kinds of options. What's the wish?
I say we accept it.
So do I.
Anyone else?
I agree.
Okay. Then I need a motion.
So moved.
Support.
Moved by Mr. Weed with support from Ms. McGuire that we do accept the offer of $50,000 for the 8,000 area.
One comment.
Yes, sir.
There were some conditions attached to the offer. We might consider making the motion subject to successful accommodation of those conditions or mutual agreement and satisfaction of those conditions, including the contingency that resolution be acceptable to our township attorney.
I concur with that.
Me also.
Okay. Got that?
No.
Sorry.
I got so far that subject to the successful agreement of the
township attorney, just put that.
Township attorney?
Pending legal review.
Pending legal review?
Mm-hmm. Okay. And development of mutually agreeable. Yeah. Sorry. I could write it down.
Yes, please write it down because this is.
Please don't.
Okay. Pending township attorney approval and
development of mutually agreeable conditions.
You guys don't make anything easy anymore. Okay, got it.
Sorry.
All right, roll call, please.
Mr. Gajewski.
Yes.
Mr. Weed.
Yes.
Ms. McGuire.
Yes.
Mr. Cummings.
Yes.
Ms. Carrasco, yes. Mr. Beyer.
Yes. I thought Mr. Moore had some strong arguments.
The only thing I'm concerned with, Jim, is, I mean, they wouldn't even come in the middle, the one that you counter-offered with. And I hope this don't show precedence that we're going to buckle for everybody that comes to our door. Mm-hmm. This is, I mean, I voted yes, but with regret, but I mean, we got to look at that in the future.
Mm-hmm. I don't think it's buckling, Marty. I think that you have to look at all the things that are in play, some of the things, you know,
I agree, but there's all the big doors out there.
Oh, yeah, Amy. Understandable.
And they're going to come slapping us, too.
That's fine.
I think the first test of what you're saying is the potential sale of either this building or the Seisen Schmidt building.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
You're only talking a difference of $20,000, you know what I'm saying?
Something we got to consider in the future.
It's back on the tax rolls, so.
Okay. All right, I guess the motion is passed. We are down to a public comment, second public comment. No cards required. Anybody have anything they wish to say? There were a bunch of dummies here or something like that? Hearing none, move on to board comment.
I have one item.
Yeah.
Regarding the dust control, the mineral brine that they are using, I would like to see a chemical composition report from a certified laboratory so we know what's in that brine. Is that acceptable?
Mm-hmm. I think they supply that.
I think they give us that.
I think they give us that when they come in. Mm-hmm. Right in the truck.
All right. Just want to make sure that we get to review over that.
Do you get such a report, Bob?
I can double check. I'm not positive.
Right.
Okay. I believe so, but I don't.
I think we do.
I don't want to speculate.
Okay.
I think we have.
Jim, maybe I was confused. Did we decide that we were going to take the two topics that I asked about earlier? Is that part of this agenda or the work session?
This one.
This one, yeah.
Okay.
This is the time.
Thank you. I didn't write it down.
Mm-hmm.
Well, why don't you, as item C, you had two.
I did. First one.
First one.
All right, the server for the police department. It was proposed on the April 11th agenda. There was a quote, couple of configurations were proposed by IT Wright and by Dell, and we were just discussing the need to take a look at those because they were outside the scope of the IT project that was approved prior to my starting on the board here. And I was just working with Bob to come back and say that actually the though the IT Wright quote was slightly above Dell's quote, since IT Wright is our outsourced vendor for IT because they specialize in municipal software and hardware, that we in fact actually go with the slightly higher quote because it would create continuity in the service and support of the hardware and the software. Also, in working with the IT Wright, I discovered that the quote reflected a best practice that they've established as to how this software that they need to run in the police department has successfully and been stably running in other municipalities. So we just didn't have a way to compare the server configuration to anything that we were trying to run today. So that was the reason that I wanted to bring this up.
Okay. Does this require any action?
I don't know. In fact, Bob, you can speak to that point.
Sure.
Yeah.
It is below the $2,000 administrative purchasing authority, but as Tim indicates, it's outside the scope of the original project. We have to do it. It's a requirement. So my intent was to proceed with it, unless there's some objection for the board under the administrative purchasing authority that I or anybody in my position has been granted, subject to the direction that we've developed with Tim's investigation.
Okay. So I think we're fine.
Next item.
Yes, sir. All right. So the municipal software.
What is it?
Municipal software.
Oh, unit.
Which Unitrex. Is called what again?
Munitrex.
Munitrex. Yes. Thank you. Yeah, they didn't show that very long in the screen. Primarily, I attended a webinar by the vendor of this software to understand what it was that the software would do for us. Why would we care to spend $2,500, I think it is, for this annual subscription. So what I discovered was actually that it had several features, some of which I wasn't aware of. I walked into this to be told what it was going to do. It's not a daily transactional accounting package. You don't go in and put in your daily transactions in this. Instead, what it's used for is reporting. So periodically, you would create what's called a trial balance out of our general ledger system, and you'd feed this information into a system which resides on the internet. It's essentially, it would be a database out there, it would take this information. And the purpose is that it would provide reporting of our expenditures, our budgets, and it would allow us to not only provide that information to the community, which I'll get to more in a moment, but it also allows us to see what other municipalities are spending. So we can compare across any of the categories which are standard for municipal organizations. So it's actually quite nice. So though it's $2,500, you know, one would normally kind of go, okay, well, you know, why would it be worth that? So then it comes back to whether or not it saves some of the time for the treasury, you know, and does it save any of their time, or for Bob. And I basically concluded that it was a good value. The a couple features that were interesting was that it completes automatically some forms that are useful in submitting for grants. There's a financial reporting, a financial statement that you need to fill in. So being that this is automatic, it's We've never not submitted a grant because of the paperwork, but it was nice to be able to have this done faster and automatically. They did it for me literally within 30 seconds, and it was amazing. It was very nice. And then lastly was a feature that allows us to be able to add a page to our existing website that reports these exact expenditure and budget figures. That was really nice because it creates a transparency with the community. So there's the end of my rather long-winded report.
Tim, did they have anything under financial reporting as far as like auditing that we could do ourselves instead of having the auditors do it?
I didn't see that. That wasn't a feature that I was presented. It doesn't mean it's not there. Bob?
Well, one thing it does do, it doesn't help from the auditing standpoint, that would be helpful is that it basically helps to complete that EVIP state sharing, state revenue sharing report every year. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the transparency report, which is fairly labor intensive from a staff standpoint.
Thank you, Tim.
Okay. Do we need to make that an action item? Or are you bringing that back to the board?
I can bring it back, maybe with the information, just to refresh everybody. Does that sound good?
Yep.
Yes. Okay. Anything else regarding our other category? If not, public comment.
Anybody?
We did that.
We did that.
We're down in this board comment.
Go ahead.
I just had a question. With the DNR trust purchase of the property, mm-hmm. Do you require a state appraiser to appraise that property, or is it done according to the township appraisal? How is that handled?
It's an independent appraisal, and the state has to approve the appraisal report, and then they base their grant on the percentage that we've applied for of that approved amount.
Has that already taken place?
It has not.
Oh, I see. So that's the next.
Mm-hmm. That's the next step.
Yes.
Okay. The state is pretty close. They don't just give you money and walk away. They do monitor. Yes. Good question.
Thank you.
Okay. Any further comment, question from? Yes.
I would just like to thank the board for accepting our offer on the 8,000 area. I guess we'll need probably getting in touch with Bob and Ann as far as working on details on this. So we will be in touch with you. I think it's a workable solution for both the board and for our homeowners. I think everybody's going to be happy with this. And like I say, if we should develop any plans that, a frisbee golf course or something like that, anything we might do with the property will be open to the public. We'll be sure to let the board know. And this isn't just for us. This is for the community as a whole. So, we would encourage people, even right now, even though we don't own it at this moment, but we do have a lot of people come in there and use the property for walking their dogs and things like that. And of course, that will continue. And so I just want to thank you for your unanimous vote to accept our offer. I appreciate it. Thanks.
Anyone else? Yes, sir.
On the dust control, how many applications do you plan on making? Because I know that 1 year you used a certain chemical, and I think you did two applications, and then 1 year you went to different chemicals and you did three.
Right.
So I was wondering.
I'm guessing two this time. What's your agreement with the dust company?
I believe we left ourselves the opportunity to do three, and it's partially weather dependent.
Yeah.
So.
They do, depends on how much rain during the summer. If it gets dusty in August or something like that, we might go to three. But
we had a call or come into the township, and they had to return on our road. I've been at that road out there.
Okay.
And we've been up here about three times because it seems that we get left out of a loop at times.
Okay.
So that's why I was wondering how many applications.
Which road is that?
Bennett Lake.
Bennett Dam Road.
I see.
They had to come all the way from Caucasian one time because they missed our road. So
Can't do that again.
Who monitors their applications?
Essentially, our DPW folks are right with them when it's happening. They ride with them.
So are they doing a checklist or something to make sure that they don't miss roads?
We have a map and follow the route on the map. That's how the drivers ensure that they've covered all the routes, is with our input.
Okay. Last chance. Anybody else? Board comment. Anything from the board? Okay. Then I need a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Okay. Thank you for coming, everybody. We are adjourned.